Today we are going to talk about relations and functions, composition of functions, and inverse of a functions. Now, composition of function is basically everywhere. Okay, almost 99, in fact, I claim that almost all the functions are basically composition of two or more functions. Okay, now what is the composition of a function? Let me define it first. Composition of functions. Okay, let me define this in a simple layman pictorial view to you. Let's say there is an input x. Okay, let's say there's an input x. You put it in a function, let's say g. Let's say the function name is g. What do you get as an output? We get g of x. Correct? So this is the output that you get when you put an input into a function g, right? When this input is put into another function, let's say a function name is f. Okay, then you get something which we call as f of g of x. Right, so it's basically a function of a function. Right, this is a function of a function. Now, if you could devise another machine, let's say G and F were machines. So, if you put an input X into the machine G, it will give you G of X. Let's say if you put the input G of X into another machine, right, that is the output from G into another machine, let's say F. I will get f of g of x. Now let's say I devise another machine which directly gives you this output. Then that machine will be called as fog machine. This is the symbol that we represent, used to represent f of g of x. F of g of x. This is how we pronounce it, fog. Okay, not the do one, but yes, it gets its name as FOG. Now many people ask, sir, could there be further more, you know, nesting of functions? Yes, let's say if you put this into another function, let's say I put this to another function h, then I would get something like h of f of g of x. As you can see, there is now three levels of nesting: f of h of f of g of x. Okay, so if I devise a machine which directly gives you this output from x, then I would call that machine as HOFOG. Pronunciation is quite weird. HOFOG, HOFOG. Okay, I'll give you an example. From example, probably you'll be able to understand that what is composition of function. Now, let me tell you, my dear students, when I say f of g of x, it doesn't mean f of x into g of x. Now see, there are normally five types of operations normally we perform between functions. We can add them, right? You can add two functions. You can subtract two functions. You can multiply two functions. You can divide one function by another function. And the fifth one is you can take a composition of functions. So addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, what we call as quotient also sometimes, and the fifth one is composition of functions. So this is what we are learning today, the fifth operation between function, which is the composition of two functions. Let me give you a simple example. Probably from that example you'll be able to understand it very clearly. Let's say I have a function defined from real numbers to real numbers as e to the power x. Okay, and I have another function g of x. Let me write from where to where it is defined. So let's say, yeah, this function is defined as x to the power 3 minus 5. Okay, so these are the two functions, f and g. F is defined from r to r. What does this r mean? The domain, yes. What does this R mean? Codomain. Okay. So domain and codomain both are real numbers for both of these functions, right? Now, if I say find f of g of x, okay. If I say f of g of x, Okay, what will be that function? Normally we write it like this also, or you may write it like this also. It all depends upon how you present it. Here you don't have to put unnecessary brackets. Here probably you'll have to put, you know, two brackets, one inside the other. Yes, can anyone tell me what is the f of g of x function? So see, f is eating e to the power x. That means in place of x over here, e to the power x is eating x cube minus 5. So basically this will go in place of x over here. That is the meaning of f of g of x. It just means that replace your x with g of x. So this entire x you will remove from there. And what will you place in lieu of that? You will place x cube minus 5 there. And this is what you will end up seeing. This is going to be your answer. Are you getting my point? Any questions here? Arey, it is not corona inside the house. Yeah, don't wear mask inside the house. Okay. Yeah. Is this clear? Okay. Now, should I ask you a question? Tell me, what is GOF? What is GOF? G of f of x. Please type it in your chat box. I want to see if you have understood it. What is GOF? GOF means you're putting f of x in place of x itself in g. So in g, the x is to be replaced with what? F of x itself, right? So what is it? Yashashwani, Smriti, what is the answer going to be? Tell me. Are you finding it difficult to write or something? Okay. Is it big enough to write? Okay, let me help you. So it will be, so what you do is the entire e to the power x will go and replace the x over here. See, this entire e to the power x will go in absolutely Pranava. So it will be e to the power x cube minus 5. You can say e to the power 3x minus 5. Getting the point? Nothing difficult about it. Okay, try one more. What is FOF? Yes, the function can also feed itself. Okay, this is called recursive. You are calling the function itself. What is FOF? FOF. This x will be replaced by e to the power x itself. So it will become e to the power x. Is that fine? Okay. What is GOG? So this entire function will be fed in place of x in the same function. This entire function, listen to my words carefully. This entire function will be fed in place of x itself. So it will become x cube minus 5 cube minus 5. Are you getting my point? Trust me, most of the functions that you will get, my dear students, would be composition of functions. Okay. Now, right now, whatever examples you have seen, whether this is this example, or this example, you must be wondering that if I make a composition of function, what is going to be the domain and what is going to be the range of it? That's actually a very, you know, important thing to address, because we cannot write a function as we have written it here. We should mention its domain and range, or at least domain and codomain. Correct? Now here is something which we need to understand. All of you, please listen to this. This is the most vital part of this discussion. I know you are finding this easy. It's very simple. Okay. But try to understand a very vital part of this discussion. I'll write it over here. Very important. From the previous example, it must be appearing that it's a cakewalk, right? Pick up a function, put it in the place of x in the other function, and you're done. That is the composition of functions. You're not completely wrong. You're not completely right also. When we are finding f of g of x, we need to exercise a precaution. What is the precaution? I'll just tell you. Let's say there's a function f which is from a to b, okay, and there's another function g which is from, let's say, c to d. Okay, a and b are their respective domain and codomain for f, and c and d is basically the respective domain and codomain for g. Okay, now does fog always exist? Can we always find fog for any function given to us? The answer is no, right? So what restriction or what criteria I must fulfill if my fog has to exist? So listen to this criteria. If fog has to exist, if fog exists, then remember, range of g, which is g function, the function which has been fed, right? So this is what? This is f of g, right? F of g. So the range of this function, which is inside the bracket, that must be a subset of domain of f. This condition is very important. If this condition is not fulfilled, you cannot find fog. Are you getting my point? Any questions here? Now, people ask me why. The reason to this is very simple. If the output given by the inside function is beyond the taking capabilities of the outside function, then it will not know what to do with those values. I'll give you a simple example. I'll give you a very simple example. Let's say I have a function g which is defined as x plus 1. Okay, and its domain is from 1 to 2. Okay, so only in the domain 1 to 2 this function is defined. And how does this function behave? It behaves as x plus 1 in that particular domain of x. Okay, now you tell me, what will be the range of g? Anybody, please tell me the range of g. Write it down on the chat box. If your input is from 1 to 2, output will be from? Range means output. Range means output, right? Yeah, so what will be the output? 2 to 3. Thank you, Aishwarya. So it will be from 2 to 3. Correct. Okay. Now let's say I define another function. Let me write it in yellow. I'm giving an example over here. Let's say I write another function f of x, which is x square. Okay. And this function only works for 0 to 1. Okay. Beyond this, the function does not exist. Right? Is that clear? Okay. Understood the definition of g, understood the definition of f. Okay. Now, what is the domain of f? You'll say, simple, sir. You have already written it. Why you're asking us? Just to confirm. So, domain is 0 to 1. Now, can I find f of g of x? Can I find f of g of x, my dear student? Think and answer. Yes or no? Yes or no? Press on the poll button. Yes or no? Can I find f of g of x? Yes versus no. They are very close to each other. Come on, come on. Everybody should vote. Come on. Fast, fast, fast. Bega, bega. Everybody. Okay, I'll close the poll in another 10 seconds. Okay, at the count of 5, you must all have voted. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Go for it. Are you 10 people still left to vote? Fast. Okay, fine. Why? Why morning you people are giving me a shock? The answer is no, my dear. The answer is no, we cannot find f of g. The reason being, the output of g is from 2 to 3. And the input capabilities is only from 0 to 1. Correct? So if you, let's say the output comes out to be 2.5. And you put in the place of x in f. Okay. So can I find f of 2.5? Can I find this out? we cannot find it out, because this guy will say, hey, I'm only designed to work between 0 to 1. Why are you putting 2.5 inside me? Right? See, simple. Let's say you are a function. Like, okay, you are a function. Okay. Let's say I design you like this. When you see your dad, give him coffee. Okay, so when your dad comes from the office, give him coffee. Okay. And when you see your mom, or when your mom comes from work, from coffee, from office, give her a tea. Okay, so this is how I designed. So who are in your, under your domain? Only papa and mama are there. Dad and mom are there. Okay. Let's say you open the door and you see your brother or sister coming in. Will you know what to do with them? No, because I have not designed you, or I have not given any instructions to you that when you see your siblings, what to do with them? Should you give them tea? Should you give them coffee? Should you give them milk? Okay. So you are only designed to work under two conditions: when you see your mom and when you see your dad. In the same way, this guy F, think as if it is a function which is only designed to work for 0 to 1. Domain means what? Domain means these are the only inputs for which it will work. Beyond that, if you put anything, it will refuse to work. That is the meaning of domain. Yes or no? So when your G of X output is from 2 to 3, it is not under the domain or not under the processing capabilities of F. So it will say, boss, please do not try this out. I cannot process this. So it does not exist. It does not exist. Right? Please do not start writing, you know, simple. Please do not start doing substitution, because half the people here, if I ask this question to them, they will just say X plus 1 the whole square. No, it is not that simple. It is not that simple. If you don't meet this criteria, you cannot find FOG. Have I made myself clear? This is a very vital part of composition of functions. Any questions? I'll pause here and I'll take a question from you. Now, one question that probably may arise in your mind is, what if there is a partial overlap? That is something very interesting. Let me take an example of that. Okay. Is this example clear? Anybody, any doubt? Please ask, or type clear on your chat box if it is clear. CLR, just type clear so that I can understand that you people have understood it. Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Now I'll give you another example. Just listen to that also very carefully. Let me go down. Let me just put a dash. Now I'll define a function like this. G of X function is X plus 1. Okay. For X lying between, again, let's say the same thing. 1 to 2. Okay. And f of x is another function which is defined as x square when x lies between, let's say, 1 to 1 to, you can say 1 to 4, or let's say 1 to, you can put a 2.5. Okay. Fine. 1 to 5 by 2. You can think like that. Now, let's again repeat the whole process. For this function, what is the range? You have already told me, so no need to tell me again. 2 to 3. Correct? 2 to 3. Now, the other function is designed to work for 1 to 2.5, right? So there is a partial overlap happening. Where is the partial overlap? From 2 to 2.5. So in such cases, how do you find f of g of x? That's a question that would have come in your mind right now. When there is no overlap, that is FOG doesn't exist. No problem with that, right? The previous example. But when there is a partial overlap, how do we deal with that situation? So understand this. When there is a partial overlap, what we need to do is we need to check, all of you see here, we need to check when is this function g within this capability. So of course, one it cannot take because now for it to take a value of 1, x should have been 0, but 0 is not within its domain, right? So the minimum it can take is 2, right? And the maximum it can, you know, go till is 2.5. So when does this particular function become a 2? Of course at 1, correct? So try to understand this. When does this become a 2, the minimum of this? It becomes a 2 when x is 1, right? Yes or no? Right? And the maximum it can go is 2.5. So when does it become 2.5? It becomes 2.5 when x is 1.5. Okay. So now I'm going to find my FOG only from 1 to 1.5. Why? Because under this value of x, this output will be from 2 to 2.5, which is within the capabilities of this function. So under this definition of FOG, or under this interval of x, FOG will exist. And that will be what? And that will be nothing but x plus 1 the whole square. So this is going to be your final answer. It is slightly complicated because it requires you to think in terms of the range of G must be a subset of domain of F. So now you must be wondering, what about the other values? As you can see, I can give inputs between 1 and 2. But I can only allow to find FOG between 1 to 1.5. So what happens from 1.5 to 2? From 1.5 to 2, the function FOG will not exist. The function FOG will not exist. Are you getting my point? Now, many people ask me, sir, will we get such kind of a questions in our PU? The answer is very, very rare. It's a very rare thing that a question like this will appear. Okay. Mostly the question will fall under this category. Either it doesn't exist or the examples that we had just now taken. Okay. So don't worry too much about it. But still, I would like you to ask me any questions if you have. You can unmute yourself. You can talk. You can write any question if you want. Okay. Okay. One of you are saying, please repeat the whole process. Okay. I'm going to repeat the whole process. Now listen to this very, very carefully. Your g of x is defined as x plus 1 when x is between 1 and 2 only. Right? That is called the domain. This is the domain of g. Okay. So if this is the domain, the range is what? According to f of x, 2.5 to 2. Yeah. Yes. Now listen to this carefully, Smriti. You'll understand it from here also. So your range of g will be from 2 to 3. Correct? Now 2 to 3 is overlapping with 1 to 2.5. Right? 2 to 3 interval is overlapping. Overlapping means there's a partial overlap from 1 to 2.5. Okay? So only in those intervals where your g of x lies between 1 to 2.5, your answer FOG could be found out or can be found out. Right? Now, you just have to understand what is the maximum I can allow and what is the minimum I can allow my f of g to go. So f of g can go to a minimum of 2. Okay, which is within 1 to 2.5. So no problem with that. I have no problem with 2. Maximum it is going till 3. I have a problem with that. I have a problem with that 3 fellow because that 3 is beyond this interval. Correct? So when you put a 3 in F, F will say, my God, what is this? I was only designed to work till 2.5. Why are you putting 3 inside me? Right? So this 3 I cannot go till. What I can go till maximum is 2.5 only. That is this guy. So now I will see what input here will make it 2.5. It's a very simple calculation. So we'll say 1.5. So from 1 to 1.5 only you can put into the G of X. The reason being, then its output will be from 2 to 2.5. And then you can find your FOG. That is why this function exists. Okay. Any question here? This is a very, very important concept. Any questions? You may speak out, my dear students also. No need to type because I would understand you will have, you know, doubts which you may not be able to type properly. Clear? Okay. Acha. So, yes. Please tell me.
So according to f of x is equal to x square means 2.5 whole square, right?
No. See, 2.5 whole square when you're putting 1.5. Whatever you put inside it, you will be adding plus 1 to whole square. For example, let's say if I put 1.3, you will put 1.3 plus 1 the whole square. I'm writing a function in general. I'm not writing it for every point. For this entire interval, your function definition will go like this, x plus 1 the whole square. That is what is your f of g of x. Yes, for 1.5, it will be 2.5 square. For 1.4, it will be 2.4 square. For 1.3, it will be 2.3 square. So whatever values you put from here, you will be adding a 1 and squaring this. That will be your f of g. What I'm interested in you understanding is, if I go beyond 1.5, I will not be able to find the function. The reason being, if I put 1.6 in G, let's say, I take a simple example, 1.6 in G, my output will become 2.6. So now you're putting 2.6 inside F. F will become angry. F will say, why are you putting 2.6 inside me? I'm only designed to work till 2.5. Are you getting my point? That's why I have to restrict the input of G so that the output of G is restricted to the domain of F. It's a little long thought. You have to restrict your input of G such that the output of G is within the domain of F. Are you getting my point? Any more questions? Anybody? This is a concept which many good students also are not able to understand. Okay. So if you have understood it, hats off. Very good. Okay, when I was studying this chapter almost 15-16 years ago, okay, I equally had the same trouble in understanding. But once you know you start solving questions on this, you'll be able to understand. Now, coming back to this, this is a very vital concept that you have understood right now. So let me erase this. Okay, another thing that we need to keep in mind is that The domain of FOG will actually be a subset of domain of G. Very important. As you can see in this example, this is the domain of FOG. This is the domain of FOG. As you can see, 1 to 1.5 is a subset of domain of G. It is within that. It can be equal to also, but it is within that. Okay, so domain of FOG will be a subset of the domain of G. Are you getting my point? So these two vital things you need to understand while finding composition of functions. If this is understood, now I will like to move on to the concept, to the properties of composition of functions. Please ask if you have any questions here. Okay, let's take few examples, Just one more example for our sake of clarity. Let's say I have a function g defined as x square, okay, from 1 to 3. 1 to 3, okay. And I have a function g, which is, f, which is defined as 2x minus 1, okay. If your output lies between 2 to 5, okay. Is that fine? Think very carefully before answering. Find FOG. I'll give you a minute. So when you're defining it, please tell me how it is defined and for what values of x. So these two you have to tell me while you're defining it. Okay. Think very carefully and then answer. Let's have a minute for this. Don't be in a hurry. Take your time. That's very important. Okay, let me give you options. I think then you'll be able to respond to me. So let's say I give you options. These are your options. Option number A. The function will be defined as, let me write it like this. The function will be defined as 2x square minus 1. For x lying between this option number B, it will be defined as 2x square minus 1 if x lies between 2 to 3. Okay. Option number C, it will be defined as 2x square minus 1 if x lies between root 2 to root 5. And option number D, FOG is defined as this if x lies between 2 to 5. Okay. Now see, I'm not playing with the definition. Definition, everybody knows what is going to be. Okay. I'm just playing with this guy, these tables. Okay. So I'll on the poll option for you. On that poll option, I want everybody to respond. Okay. Your time starts now. I'll give you 1 minute for this. Somebody has given the answer. Kirtana. Very good, Kirtana. Not saying right or wrong to anybody. I'm just saying very good if you have responded. This single question will make me understand that whether you have understood the concept or not. Everybody, please vote. Last 30 seconds, time is running out. Last 10 seconds, my dear students, come on, 20 people still left to vote. Come on. At the count of 5, I'll stop. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Go. Please vote. Please vote. Please vote, everybody. I don't get to know what you have voted. Don't worry. 12 people still left to vote. Okay. Never mind. Let's see the result. Okay. This is the verdict of... I hope you can see the result. Oh yeah, now you can see the result. So Janta has said B. 55% of you have said B. Okay. Then the next highest vote has gone to A. Okay. Let's see what is correct, whether A or B or none of them. Okay. Let's see. Everybody. Now here comes your understanding. When you look at this interval for the domain of G, okay. Everybody, if you know the graph of x square, this is the graph of x square, right? Okay, this is the graph of x square, a parabola, correct? From 1 to 3, the graph will go from 1 to 9, right? So this output, let me write it over here. The range of G will be from 1 to 9. Anybody has any doubt with this? If your function is x square and your input is from 1 to 3, the output will be from 1 to 9. That is 1 square to 3 square, which is 1 to 9. Any doubt with this, anybody? No doubt. Now, the input capabilities for f is only between 2 to 5. Right? So it is not going to work beyond 2 to 5. Right? It's like the working hour for f. Okay, no matter how much money you give him, he will not work beyond 2 to 5. Okay, but the requirement here is from 1 to 9. So there is a partial overlap. All of you please see. Let's say 1 to 5 is this. 2 to 5 is this and 1 to 9 is this. So you can see that there is a partial overlap occurring over here. Okay. Now, partial overlap means we cannot put 1 and 3 inside your G because if you do that, the output will exceed the input capabilities of F. So what do we suggest the students? Very simple. If you want to know from where to where the function will work, just substitute x square in place of x over here. So if x square is from 2 to 5, x will be from root 2 to root 5. I mean, roughly speaking. Okay, of course, this is not the exact interval. Okay, so in this interval from root 2 to root 5, the outcome of this function will be within 2 to 5. That is what we have known, right? So only in this input, your function is going to work. Else it is not going to work. So only from root 2 to root 5, you can substitute this x square in place of x over here, and option number C will be the only right option. Okay, so Kirtana was the first one to get this right. Very good. Rest, most of the people went wrong in this. Getting my point? So your output must be output. This is the output, no? Your output must be within the input of this. So when you do that, you end up getting x lying between root 2 to root 5. Now you should also check whether it is between 1 to 3 or not. Yes, root 2 to root 5 is very much within 1 to 3. So you can take the entire interval. Is it fine? Okay. Let's understand the properties. Let's understand the properties of composition of functions. Composition of functions. The first property the first property that we are going to talk about is composition of functions is not commutative. That means f of g of x need not be g of f of x. Okay. Spurti. Spurti, if you can hear me, please do not scribble on this on the screen. Okay. I can know who is scribbling on the screen. Fine. Spurti, please do not scribble on the screen. Fine. Okay. That means FOG is not equal to GOF. FOG is not equal to GOF. Okay. So in general, sudo also. Please do not write anything on the screen. This function is not commutative in general. Not commutative in general. It's very easy. It's very easy to verify this also. Let's say I make a function like e to the power x and the other function as, let's say, sine of x. Okay. Of course, I'm considering that FOG and GOF can be found out. So FOG in that case will be what? FOG is where you are feeding sine x in place of x. Okay. That will be e to the power sine x. Right? And GOF will be what? GOF is where you are feeding e to the power x in place of x over here. That is sine of e to the power x. Of course, they are not equal. Of course, these two are not equal. Right? So we cannot say FOG and GOF are equal. That's the first property which we need to understand. Okay. They are equal under one situation. What is that situation? We'll discuss that in today's class. Don't worry. Any question with respect to this property? So FOG is not equal to GOF in general. In general means most of the time. Of course, under few situations, they may be equal. Okay. Next property. Next property is FOGOH. Let's say I have a composition of three functions. Okay. It is same as FOGOH. It means they are associative. Composition of function is associative. So if you find FOG first, okay, and in that you feed H, that means FOGOH, this one. It is same as if you are feeding GOH to F. See, basically this is writing like this, FOG. Yeah, this is what I mean to say when I write it like this. Okay, this means in F of G of H, I am feeding H. So ultimately, you'll see that you have written the same thing both the sides, right? So it doesn't matter first whether you do FOG or whether you do GOH. Ultimately, FOGOH will be the same. Let me give you an example. Let's now have three functions. Can you all give me any function? Anybody who wants to give me a function, suggest me any function. Any function. Tell me any function which you know. Tan of x. Okay. Tell me another one. Let's say log of x or ln of x. Ln means log to the base e. Okay. Tell me another one. Let's say x to the power 5. Okay, so these are your, let's say, three functions. Fine. Now, if somebody says find FOGOH, let's say somebody says find this function. What does he mean? He means that first find FGOH. So we have to first find GOH. GOH means you have to feed H to G. So this fellow will be fed here. It will become ln of x to the power 5. Any question? Okay. Now, second step is where you are finding FOGOH. FOGOH means this function will be fed in place of x in tan. So it will become tan of ln of x to the power 5. Any question here? Anybody has any doubt in understanding tan of ln of x to the power 5? How does it come? Clear? Everybody is clear? Okay. Now we'll find the other one. Let's say I call this as A. Now I'll find B. What is B? B is FOGOH. Bracket means you have to first do this activity. So let me find FOG first. FOG means how will I get FOG? Who will tell me FOG? Please write it on your screen, on your chat box, FOG. This is F. Look at, this is your F, this is your G. Okay. What is FOG? Write it down on your chat box. FOG means you're feeding G to F. Absolutely, Pranava. Tan of ln X. Very good. So FOG will be tan of ln X. Tan of ln X. Okay. We write it properly. FOG. Okay. Now second step is finding FOG bracket OH. Means H is fed to this function. What is H here? H is x to the power 5. So if I feed x to the power 5 to this function, it means its x will get replaced with x to the power 5. Is that fine? Do you want me to take few more questions on these kind of stuff? Because I'm feeling that most of you are restricting yourself from answering because the concept is not very clear. So what I'll do is I'll give you more questions so that the idea is clear. Now let me complete this property. As you can see, this term and this term are the same. These two terms are the same. And that is what I meant by the property that FOGOH in bracket is same as FOGOH. Okay. Now before that, I'll do some exercise with you. Some questions I will take. Okay. Let's say I have sine x as my f of x. Okay. Let's say my g of x is a root of x. Okay. And let's say my h of x is, let me take an example of another function. Let's take 5 to the power x. Okay. Now, all of you, please answer the following questions. What is FOHOG? Okay, I'll give you options because you're not going to write it down. Many of you prefer voting actually. So I'll give you options. Which is FOHOG? FOHOG. You can pronounce it as a very funny name. FOHOG. Okay. Is it option one? Root of 5 to the power sine x. Okay. Is it sine of 5 to the power root x? Okay. Or is it sine to the power under root of 5 to the power x? Or is it 5 to the power sine of root x? Okay, so four options are given, A, B, C, D. Please choose one of them. Okay, your time starts now. I hope you can see the poll. Okay, think carefully and answer. I'm asking, what is FOHOG? FOHOG. Nine of you have voted so far. Very good. Everybody, please vote. Don't worry. I don't get to know who is voting what. Okay. It's completely anonymous to me. But don't start scribbling on the screen because then I can know who is doing that. Last 15 seconds, my dear. I don't think so. It's more than a minute question. Last 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Go. Dig, 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 dig. Okay, let me stop. This is what Janta has said. Janta has said option B. Okay. So Janta, let me tell you, option B is correct. Okay. Very simple. You first have to feed G to H. So when you feed G to H, you can find it in any order you want. When you find G to H, basically it becomes under root of 5 to the power X. Oh, sorry. G to H you have to find. Sorry, sir. My mistake. So you have to feed this to this guy. So it'll become 5 to the power root x. And now you have to feed this to f. So now you have to feed this to f. So f o g o h will be sine of 5 to the power root x. So that is option B only. Very good. Okay. Now you have understood. One more we'll take up so that I'm confident that you have understood it. Okay. Let's find h o f o g, hofog. Okay. These are your options. Five to the power sine of root x, sine to the power, sorry, sine of under root of 5x, 5 to the power x. Okay. Under root of 5 to the power sine x. Or 5 to the power of under root of sine x. Okay. Let me check whether the right option is there inside it or not. Yeah. So let me launch the poll now. Think carefully and answer. I want 100% correct result this time. Okay. Voting is on. Very good. Think carefully, then answer. Very good, dears. Very good. Nice. Please vote. Please vote. 22 of you are still to vote. Last 20 seconds left. Fast, fast. Last 10 seconds. Last 10 seconds. Last 10 seconds. Last 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Please vote, please vote. 14 of you are still waiting. I don't know why. Vote. Okay. There you go. 69% Janta has gone for A. Janta, you are Janadan. Janta is correct. Option A is right. Okay. Very simple. First you feed G to F. First you feed G to F. When you feed G to F, it will become sine of root x. Okay. And then you're feeding this to h. So the sine of root x you're feeding to h. So it'll become 5 to the power that term. So 5 to the power sine of root x, option A is correct. Okay. Very good. Now I don't think so you will have any doubt in understanding this property. Now let's go to property number 3. Property number 3 is, this is a slightly theoretical property. If f of x is 1, 1, okay, and g of x is also 1, 1, 1, 1 means 1, 1 function, okay, then please remember f o g or g o f, whatever you want to call it, that will also be a 1, 1 function. That will also be a 1, 1 function. If f o g is 1, 1, if f of x is 1, 1, g of x is 1, 1, then f o g will also be a 1, 1 function undoubtedly. Undoubtedly. Is that fine? Okay. Now, let's take few questions that are there in your, you know, chapter. We'll start with, let me start with a very simple one. Let's say your f of x is defined from this set to, let's say, this set, 1, 2, 5. What does it mean? It means this is basically your domain and this is basically your codomain. G of x is defined from 1, 2, 5 to 1, 3. Okay. Now, f of x is known to be, f of x is known to be, in fact, I should not write f of x, I should just write the relation f. Okay, the relation f is known to be 1, 2, 3, 5, okay, 4, 1. Okay, and g is defined as 1, 3, 2, 3, and 5, 1. Okay. My question is, find GOF in this. Find GOF in this. Now, before you start solving this question, I would like you to pause for a minute and listen to me. Is composition of function only allowed in function? The answer is no. It is also allowed in relations. In fact, whatever is applied to functions, the same concept is applied to relations also. Okay? Because functions are within relations. Relations are a bigger set. Function is a small subset out of it. So even you have composition of relations also. Okay. Now think as if these are two relations. F and G are two relations. You have to find GOF. How will you find it out? In case you are done with it, please type the ordered pairs that you think. Please write this in the rooster form. Okay, I think you are aware of what is a rooster form. So write down the rooster form for this set. That means which all elements will be there in GOF. Think carefully and answer, my dear. Think carefully and answer. This time I'm not going to give you options. Again, hint to solve this. You must be guided by what is the, see, this is g of f of x, right? Right? So what is the output of this and what output g gives for that input? I'll give you a simple example in this. I'll not complete it. I'll just give you one ordered pair which is there in your answer. See, when you put 1 inside this function, the output is 2. So this is your input and this is your output, right? Correct? Yes or no? Now this output is now going inside G. Correct? So check which of the ordered pairs starts with a 2. So out of these three, which starts with a 2? Yeah, there this go. This go. This starts with a 2. Correct? So when you put 2 inside it, it'll give you 3. Isn't it? So the answer is, when you put a 1, you should get a 3 as the answer. So here 1, 3 will come out as an ordered pair. Okay. Absolutely correct, Madiha. Well done. Madiha has absolutely given the right answer. Very good. Now I've given you a hint. Please complete this now. What will be the next ordered pair? It's very easy. Yeah? You just understand this, you'll be able to do it like this. Aishwarya, is this, is your answer exhaustive? Have you missed out anything? Just check. Smriti also, please check. Smriti. Pranava also. Absolutely correct, Pranava. Very good. So two of you have given perfect answers. Others, I'm sure you can do it as well. Come on. Let's have, 30 seconds for this. Not more than that. 30 seconds. Very good. Yashashwini. Wonderful. You guys are awesome. Kirtana also correct. Okay, now see. Next is 3, 5. So 3 is the input to this function. 5 is the output. Now see which of them starts with a 5. There you go. This starts with a 5. So 3 and 1 will be paired up. Simple. Now 4 and 1, see which starts with a 1. Okay, this starts with a 1. So 4 and 3 will be paired up. Simple. Over. This is the answer. Okay. Any doubt here? Any questions here? Please ask. Please ask. Would you like to do one more of this type? Should we do one more? Just one more? One more? One more? Okay. Let's do one more. So next question, I'll write it over here. This time I want everybody to answer. Okay. Think carefully and answer. So let's say I have a function. Directly I'm giving you the rooster form for this. See, functions may be given in two ways to you. Functions may work on continuous domain. They may also work on discrete domain. It is not necessary that everything works on continuous domain. Okay. Some functions, they work for discrete domain also. Discrete means there is no continuity in the values of the input. Okay. Let's say this is your fng. Fine. These are functions. Okay. These two are functions. Number one, write down GOF. Okay. Number two, write down FOG. Okay. So both FOG and GOF we need to write down. So let's have the answer for the first one. So put one and then write your answer. Okay. I'll give 1 minute for this. Good enough? 1 minute. Time starts now. Don't be under the pressure of time, okay? If you feel that you need more time, you can ask, sir, 30 seconds more or 15 seconds more, I can help you with this. Don't worry about time. Correctness is more important. Correctness is more important. Please write ordered pairs. These are all ordered pairs, my dear students. Write it as ordered pairs. So what all ordered pairs will be there? Write down. Here also, what all ordered pairs will be there? Write down. Okay, Aishwarya has given one response. Very good, Aishwarya. Shusti, Smuti, very good. Very good, Yashashwani. Very good, nice. Okay. First one, I just want the answer for the first one. Don't give me the answer for the second one. I'll lose out on that information. Okay. Only the first one answer I need. No second one answer. Second one, I'll give you time. Okay, last 20 seconds. Last 20 seconds. Please wind it up. Nice. Very good, Sahana. Yes, Yashashwini, I saw your answer. Please respond. Others, there are so many people in this group. Everybody should write, no? Should I start taking names? I don't want to start taking names here. Let it be wrong. Let it be wrong. I'm not sitting here to judge anybody. I'm sitting here for helping you out. Okay, let's see. You're finding GOF first. So focus on F. When you're finding GOF, focus on F first. F is this one. Now 0, 4. See which of them starts from 4. Oh, this starts from 4. So 0 and 2 will be clubbed. So first element will be 0, 2. Okay. 2, 5. Which starts with 5? Which starts with 5? Ah, yeah. This starts with 5. So 2 and 0 will be clubbed up. Okay. 3 and 7. Which starts with 7? Ah, this starts with 7. So 3 and 2 will be clubbed up. So the answer for the first part is 3, 2. Okay. Give yourself a pat on the back if you have got it correct. Very good. I can see many of you getting the right answer. Okay. Now, FOG. Another 1 minute for it. Okay, Ashwani, I saw your answer. Pooja. Pooja, was it for... So Pooja is given for one. Okay, Pooja, give me for second one. Kavya, I can see the answer. Second one, please write second and then give your answer. Else I will be confused whether you are writing it for one or two. Good. Second one, please. Tejaswini, don't write it on the screen. Write it on the chat box. Yeah, Likhit, very good. Now people are participating. Pranava, where were you in the first one? Sanat, very good. Okay. Let's discuss. Well done to all of you who have attempted it. Now, when you're finding FOG, focus on G. Your focus should be on G, right? So 4, 2 is there. Then see which is starting from 2. Ah, second one starting from 2. So 4 and 5 will be clubbed. So 4, 5. Simple as that. Okay. Cakewalk. 5, 0. Now, which is starting from 0? Ah, first one is starting from 0. So 5 and 4 will be clubbed up. 5, 4. Okay. 7 and 2. Which is starting from 2? Which is starting from 2? The second one. So 7 and 5 will be clubbed up. 7 and 5 will be clubbed up. That's it, done. Is that fine? So this is the basic question that you will be getting in this concept. Let's take another one. Let's take a slightly serious one. Let's take this question. Okay, hope you can read this question. Question is, there is a function from R to R defined as x cube. There is a function from real numbers to real numbers defined as x cube. Okay. There's another function from again R to R defined as x square. What do we need to find? Number one, we need to find GOF. So let's find GOF first. Then we'll come to GOF of 3. Please write GOF first. It should not take you more than 5 seconds. 5 seconds questions. GOF. You can type it also on the chat box. It is so easy. Correct, Pranava. X to the power 6. All you need to do is put this in place of X over here. So it's X cube square. That is X to the power 6 over. Okay. Now, what is the domain here? Domain is for all real numbers. Now, here you don't have to check. Many people ask me, sir, you did not do that check that domain of F should be within the range of F should be within the domain of G. Correct? Range of F should be within the domain of G. See, I don't have to worry about because all of them are from real numbers. So whatever output I get from F, whatever output I get from F is well within the input capabilities of G. So that is fine. So you can directly write down the answer X to the power 6. So what is GOF3? What is GOF3? 3 to the power 6. Absolutely. Yes. Which is 9 cube, 729. Simple question. See, let's take another one. Let's take another one. Yeah, let's take this one. Hope you can see the question clearly. Question says, F is a mapping from R to R. Read the question carefully. F is a mapping from R to R. Defined like this. This is the definition of the function. G is a function from R to R. Defined like this. Correct? So first they're asking you what? GOF. First they're asking you GOF. Tell me quickly. Here you don't have to worry about seeing the range of F being a subset of domain of G, because all of them are going from R to R. Problem comes when the domain and range, etc., they are, you know, some limited sets. Okay. So tell me the answer quickly, without much waste of time. You are going to put F within G. That is what GOF means. So what's the answer? Write down the expression. Very good. 4x minus 1 cube plus 2 will be your answer. Okay. And this is also valid for all real numbers. See, make it a habit. Whenever you are writing a function, mention its domain. Right? It's a good practice. Don't just write down the definition. Definition is not the complete, you know, function. Function must always be given with its domain. Right? It's a practice. Okay. Tell me what is GOF. Oh, sorry, GOF we already did. Tell me what is FOG. FOG. Quickly. Now you're feeding G inside F. You're feeding G inside F. Absolutely, very good. So it's 4 times x cube plus 2 minus 1. Absolutely, Yashashwani. Okay, I think Madiha, slight mistake has happened in your answer. Please check. Okay, this is also true for all real numbers. Now, are they equal? Are they equal? I don't think so. They are equal. I don't think so. They are equal. Okay, you can test some for some value. So these two functions are not equal. Okay, probably you can test for a zero if you want. So GOF of zero, that will give you minus 1 cube plus 2, which is actually a 1. But FOG of zero will give you what? 4 into 0 plus 2 minus 1, which is 7. Right? So even if for one value, if it fails, we can conclude that GOF is not equal to FOG. And we also saw this in our properties also, right? So in general, they are not commutative. In general, FOG and GOF are not same. Okay. Now, boys and girls, dear students, we are not going to talk about the last part of our discussion. Inverse of a function. Inverse of a function. Yes, I know you would like to do more questions, but I think one of the sessions will devote to solving questions on inverse of a function and composition of functions. So let me take this up. Now, what is inverse of a function? Okay, so let's say I have a function f, okay, defined from a to b. Okay, so this is my function. Then what is its inverse? What is its inverse? Let me explain this in a very layman language, very simple words, right? So that you'll remember it for the rest of your life. Let's say another function g, okay, is the inverse of f. Then what actually happens? See, let me make a schematic representation of it. So let's say this is your machine f. Okay. In this machine, if I feed something, let's say, you know, this is a machine which takes water, okay, and it gives me juice, let's say mango juice, okay. If I devise another machine, let me draw it in yellow. If I devise another machine, let's say the G machine, right, where if you feed this juice, it will give you a water back. It will give you the water back. Okay. I don't think so. There is a machine in real life like this. So I have made up a machine on my own. So let's say I invented a machine G. In that machine, if you put your juice, mango juice, let's say whatever juice you want, it will return the water back to you. Okay. So then this machine is playing the reverse role of this. In fact, both the machines are inverses of each other. This is in plain and simple words. If you want to understand this concept, this is a simple example to make you understand this. So they are called inverses of each other. Right? So something which converts the output of F to input of F, that will be the inverse of that machine. Right? So you can take another example. Let's say if I put atta into this machine, it gives me chapati, let's say. Okay. Then inverse, what happens? If you feed chapati, what will it give it to you? It'll give you the atta back. Right? Hope there was a machine like this where if you put chapati, your atta will come back, which you had used to make that chapati. Okay. But unfortunately, most of the processes are irreversible in life, isn't it? This is just for your understanding purpose. Okay. So if you see from this example, it's very clear that if you feed x to this and it gives you f of x, okay, then this function feeds f of x and returns you the x back. Plain and simple language. Correct? That means your G will work with your output of F to return you the input back. So see here, I've reversed the positions here. Now, let me give you some real life mathematical example. E to the power X and log of E to the power X or log of X to the base E, both are inverses of each other. Both are inverses of each other. Okay. Another example I can give you. Why does inverse of each other? Very simple. If let's say if I feed 5 to this function, I get e to the power 5, right? Correct? If this e to the power 5, I feed to log. What do I get? I get a 5 back. So what you had input over here, you have got that back as the output. Okay, so these two functions are inverses of each other. You can do the reverse activity also. Let's say if you feed, you know, let's say 5 to this, you get log of 5 to the base e, right? And if you feed this to f, so let's say you are finding f of log of e to the power 5 means e to the power this. I'm sure you would have learned log properties. It gives you 5 only. What does log property say? A to the power log of anything to the base a is the same thing, right? Hope you are aware of this property. This is called the fundamental logarithmic identity. This is called the fundamental logarithmic identity. Okay. So these two functions are behaving as inverses of each other. Can you give me another example? Another example of two functions which are inverses of each other? Anybody? Any example? Give me correct only, huh? Okay. Let's talk about this. X square and root of x r plus to r plus. So let's say g of x is root of x. They are inverses of each other. So if one squares, other does square root of that. Right? Absolutely, Pranav. Now, a very important point over here. Please listen to this. Can I invert any function in this world? Can I find inverse of any function in this world? The answer is no. Not every functions are invertible. So which functions are invertible? Let me talk about it. Only those functions which are bijective. Okay, what is bijective? Both 1, 1 and on 2. Remember we did these classification of functions or types of functions. So only functions which are simultaneously one and onto, also called bijective functions. Okay, remember the name. One was called injective, onto was called surjective. So when both injective and surjective functions are, you know, or both of these characteristics are present in a function, we call it as a bijective function. So remember, only one and onto functions are invertible. Now the question comes, why? Why only one and onto functions are invertible? Okay. Now let me give you a case where if the function is not one, what will happen? And if the function is not onto, what will happen? Okay, let's take a case. Let's say I have a function which is not one. Let's say A, B, and C, and I have 1 and 2. Okay, now this function. Okay, let me write it as set A, set B. So this is my function f. So the mapping of the function is like this. Okay, can we have a function like this? Yes, we can have. Many one is allowed. Now, what does it mean? It means that when you are feeding A to the function f, it is giving you 1. Correct? See the arrow diagram. Arrow diagram will tell you everything. When you're feeding B to the function, you'll get a 1. And when you're feeding C to the function, you're getting a 2. Correct? Now, let me make its inverse. Let me call the inverse by the name of G. So G will work with the output and give you the input back, isn't it? Everybody please see this definition. This one. Okay. I'm basically following this. Okay. So now, if I start using the same, you know, mapping. So when I had put A, I got the output as 1. So when I put this 1 in the inverse function, I should get A back. Correct? And I should also get B back. Correct? And I put 2 into the function, I should get a C back. But let me tell you, my dear students, this is not a function at all. This is not even a function. Remember the function's criteria. The function criteria was a pre-image must give you a unique image, right? Here one is having two images to it, A and B. So forget about it being inverse of something. It is not even eligible to be called a function, right? That's why in such cases, we'll not be able to find the inverse of a function. Therefore, being one is very important. Therefore, being one is very important. Excuse me. Yeah. Now, why should be onto? Why should be onto? Let me give you an example. Another case. Let's say it is not onto. Let's say I take a dummy example. Again, A, B, C, and let's say 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, let us say it's 1, 1. But it is not onto. Okay. So here I took an example of many one and I saw what went wrong. Now I'll take an example of into and I will show you what will go wrong in this case also. So you can see here that when you put A into the function, you get 1. When you put B into the function, you get a 2. When you put C into the function, you get a 3, right? Let's make the inverse of this function. Let's make an inverse of this function. Can you all hear me? Sorry, there was a brief power cut. Can you all hear me now? Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Kirtana. All right. So now I will see that if the function is into, what will go wrong? Now let's make a function. Let's make the inverse of the function g from b to a. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and there will be a, b, c. So see, domain range positions will flip in case of inverse. Very simple. Because inverse will work with the output, right? So output will be its input. That's why b set will come as a domain now. Okay. Now see here. When you had put a into the function, it gave you 1. So when you put 1 into the function g, it should give you a. Correct? Similarly, when you had put b into the function, you had got 2. So when you put 2 into the function, you'll get a b. Similarly, this will match with c. Now you can see that 4 is left unmapped. 4 is left unmapped. What does this indicate? This indicates that boss, it is not a function. It is not a function. So forget about it being inverse. I know function. It is not even eligible to be called a function. Right? So even in the case where you have an into function, we cannot have an inverse. That's why it becomes very important that I should have a bijective function for it to be invertible. Right? Yes or no? Now, we'll talk more about it, but first few things. The notation that we normally use for the inverse is f with a superscript of minus. Please do not treat this as 1 by f. No, it is just a symbol. It is just a symbolic thing. It doesn't mean 1 by f and all. Okay. It is just a symbol used for expressing inverse of a function. Okay. Few examples which we have already seen, and I'd like to show you one more example. Let's say I talk about sine x function. Okay. A very simple thing that you need to understand from whatever discussion we had. Now, if I define sine x from R to R, okay, all of you have seen the graph of sine x function, correct? It's a sinusoidal curve like this. Yes or no? Everybody has seen sine graph, right? Okay. Now, is this function invertible? Is this function invertible? Just press yes or no right now. Can you find inverse of this function? This is the definition of sine x which I have given you right now. In the present definition, in the present form, can we find the inverse of this function? Think and answer. Think and answer. You have 15 seconds. If I've already answered, nothing can be done. But those who are supposed to vote now, I think 19 of you are supposed to vote. Okay. Please take a critical analysis and then, you know, vote. Okay. Another 15 seconds, I'll stop the poll. Okay, last 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, this is the verdict of Janta. Janta, 56% Janta says, no, you cannot find the inverse of this. You are absolutely correct. You cannot find it out because in the present form, your function is neither 1, 1. Nor onto. Why it is not 1, 1? Because if you draw a horizontal line, it is cutting the function at so many points. Correct? So it is not 1, 1. Why it is not onto? Because for onto, its codomain should be equal to the range. Range is only from -1 to 1. So it's not onto also. Right? So if it is not 1, 1 and if it is not onto, we cannot find the inverse of this function. But many people say, sir, But sine inverse exists, no? How are you finding sine inverse if sine function was not invertible? We have a whole chapter on that inverse trigonometry function. That means that chapter itself should not have existed. Okay, now hold on. In the present definition, it is not 1-1 nor onto. But by changing your domain and codomain, you can make it 1-1 and onto. Basically, you are empowered to change its domain and codomain. So, in the present stage, F inverse X does not exist, DNE. Okay. But if I redefine this function like this, everybody please see. Why not onto? See, Shrusti, onto means what? What is the definition of onto? When do you call a function onto? Oh, you forgot. Okay, it means your range should be equal to codomain. Correct? But range of sine function is only from -1 to 1, no? Right? I'll show you a sine function. Let me show you a sine function. Yeah. I hope you can see the graph. Y is equal to sine of X. Okay. You can see this function is only from -1 to 1. Range means, for finding the range of a function, you should see its Y axis span. For finding the domain of the function, you should see its X axis span. Span in the X axis. Span, you understand, right? The coverage. Coverage, right? So this is for domain. This is for range. Okay, exercise. Domain, range. Domain, range. Okay. So range of this function is only from -1 to 1. Getting the point. So if it is from -1 to 1, your codomain is all real numbers. Right? So range is not equal to codomain. So it is not onto. So if it is not onto and it is not 1-1, means it is not bijective. If it is not bijective, it is not invertible. Simple as that. Any questions here? Okay. Now what have I done? To the very same function sine X, I have curtailed the domain. So from R, I have made it like this. So this is now my domain of the function. Okay. And I have purposely made my codomain as the range. So this is the codomain of the function. This is the codomain of the function. And I have made it as the range of the function. Correct? Now you must be wondering, why did I choose this interval? Because if you just draw the graph, if you just draw the graph of sine X from -π/2 to π/2, so -π/2 is, let's say here, π/2 is, let's say here, your graph is only this much. Okay, that means only this part of the graph I have made. Only this part of the graph I have made. I'm just bubbling it up with white so that you can understand. Okay. If I make that, then what happens is any horizontal line that you will make will only cut it at one point. If it only cuts it at one point, it becomes a 1-1 function. Okay. And I have restricted my range. I have restricted my codomain to -1 to 1. Okay, so I have made it both 1-1 and onto, right? Yes or no? So now this function is invertible. So when you're defining the inverse, please remember they both will interchange their positions. So now it will become like this. Okay, and definition wise, it will become sine inverse of X. So this entire chapter of inverse trigonometry that you are going to study in your class 12th, is when you have restricted the domain and codomain of all these trigonometric function to make them 1-1 and onto. Don't worry about it right now. We'll talk about this when the chapter is being taken up. Okay. Just a second. Okay, is this fine? Now, question comes now. How do we find inverse of a particular function? Okay, let's say I know that the function is now 1-1 and I know my function is onto. How do I find its inverse? Okay, so let me take an example. Let's say my function is defined from R to R, okay, as 3x plus 5. Okay. Now, two type of questions will come in your PU exam. Number one, prove that this function is invertible and hence find the inverse. Okay. Number two is find the inverse. So if you are asked to prove that it is invertible and hence find the inverse, it will be a big question. It will be almost a 4 or 6 marker question. Because not only you have to prove that the function is 1-1 onto, but you also find its inverse. Right? So this is one type of question that comes. Second type of question is just find the inverse. Okay. So they'll say, assuming it's 1-1 or onto, or it's given that it's invertible, find the inverse. There you don't have to prove 1-1 and onto. Now many students ask me, sir, if it is not written there in the question, then what do you do in that case? Then see the marks. If it is a very high mark question, for example, 6 mark, and they've just said find the inverse, then also prove it's 1-1 and onto. Okay, so right now I'm assuming that I don't know anything about this function. The question setter has asked me, number one, show that f of x is invertible. That means it is a bijection or a bijective function. And second is find the inverse of f. So let's say these are the two things which have been asked to me in the exam. Okay. So what I'll do is first I will show it's an invertible function. So I'll write it down for bijection or for bijective. Okay. Under bijective, first I will show it's 1-1. The other day, I think you have done a lot of questions with Manish sir also regarding finding a function 1-1 or not. So what do we do? We'll say let x1 and x2 be two inputs coming from the domain of this function. This is the domain of the function and this is the codomain of the function. Such that f of x1 is equal to f of x2. Okay. That means you're trying to say 3x1 plus 5 is equal to 3x2 plus 5. Correct? Now 5 and 5 will get cancelled. 3 and 3 will also get cancelled because they're non-zero quantities. We can always cancel them off. Leaving you with x1 equal to x2 as the only possibility. Only possibility. Remember, when is the function 1-1? When assuming f of x1 is equal to f of x2 gives you x1 equal to x2 as the only possibility, then it means f of x is 1-1. Okay, I don't want to repeat the same stuff. We had done enough questions on this. Okay, next is I want to prove it's onto. Onto, what do you show? You show that your range and codomain are same. So we have to find range. So remember, how do we find range? First, we write y as the function, correct? Range, domain is already known to us. Domain is real numbers. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make x the subject of the formula. Correct? So I'm going to make x the subject of the formula. Now, if I want to ask you for what value of y does this function give you a real value of x, you will say it gives you for every real values of y. That means your range of this function is all real values, right? So now check here. Codomain is also all real values. range here is also all real values. Both are equal. And hence the function, or therefore it implies that f of x is onto function, right? So this is something which you need to do if you are asked to show that the function is invertible, right? But don't forget to write the final comment, since f of x is both 1-1 and onto, it implies f of x is a bijective function, Bijection or bijective function, both are same things. Okay. And hence, f of x is invertible. Okay. So first part of the function, you are done. First part of the question, you are done. Any questions here, please ask. Regarding proving 1-1, regarding proving onto, any questions? No questions? Clear, everybody? Okay. So first part is done. First part of the question is done. Let's do the second part of the question. Second part of the question is finding the inverse of this function. Now, all of you try to understand here. You have been given this function, correct? Yes or no? Now, what are you trying to find? This function, correct? Yes or no? Now, everybody here knows that the output of the inverse, when it is fed to the input of the function, I will get the input back. This is by the very definition of inverse. This is from the definition of the inverse only. See, f and f inverse, both are inverses of each other, right? Inverse is not only one directional, right? So if machine g is the inverse of f machine, f is also the inverse of g machine. So e to the power x is inverse of ln x. Ln x will also be the inverse of e to the power x. Vice versa happens. Okay, it's not one-sided. Okay, so if a machine is taking water and giving you juice, and another machine is taking juice and giving you water, then both the machines are inverses of each other. Getting my point? So from this definition, it is very clear that this output should have been y. Correct? Yes or no? So this is actually your y, right? So f of y is going to give you an x, correct? And vice versa. That means if you put f into the inverse function, I should get x back. So both these relations are true, correct? That means f inverse of y will also give you an x. Right? So what I'm trying to explain you over here, just get it in a simple word. Let me take it to the right. When you're finding the inverse function, you just have to find out basically this. Because this is as good as saying y is equal to f inverse x. Are you getting my point? Yes or no? Right? So what I'm going to do here is that in order to find this, right, I'm just going to see the process. I'm going to start with the given function, correct? I'm going to make x the subject of the formula. Okay, this is method number one. There's one more method I'll tell you, method number one. So first of all, I'm going to write x in terms of y. The very same step that you had written while finding or while proving it was onto, this step. This step I'm repeating once again. Correct? Right? Now basically what have you done? You have come to this step. Right? You have come to this step. Correct? So this function here, okay, is basically a function which is giving you f inverse y. Okay, let me again rewrite this so that you are able to understand. We need to find this, isn't it? We need to find this. Correct? Yes or no? Correct. And from your function, if you're doing this term, if you're doing this activity, let me take my camera a little up or camera to the right. So this is what you have done right now. This is what you have done right now. So you have found something called f inverse y, right? But I need to find f inverse x. So what do? In the same thing, I replace my y with x, and we are done. So x minus 5 by 3 will become your inverse of this function. So if this function is your f of x, this function will be its inverse. Simple as that. So I'll repeat the steps. Just follow this step. Step number one. Write y is equal to that function. Step number two. Make x the subject of the formula. Step number three, this part of the function, you replace your y with an x. Let me write it over here. And that is going to be your answer. Okay. So here, make x the subject of the formula. Make x the subject of the formula. And here just replace your y with x. Replace y with x in this part. Okay. And this is done. This is your inverse of the function. Right? And if you want to test it out whether you actually got a right answer, try doing this. Remember, we had done composition of functions. Okay, so try feeding one function to the other. Okay, let's say I do this. That means I'm feeding this to 3x plus 5. So see what will happen. 3 into. Okay, see what will happen. It will give you the input back. So this input has come outside as the answer. Okay, here also this input will come out as the answer. Check. Now I'm putting this entire function to this guy. Five get cancelled, three get cancelled, so you end up getting an x back. That means your result is absolutely correct. Your result is absolutely correct. Let me give you one more question. Any questions on this? Any questions on this on how to find the inverse? I think one more practice we'll do, then we'll be able to understand it in a better way. Okay. Let's say my question is, it's known that this function is invertible. Let me give the function as 2x minus 1. Okay. It is known that it is invertible. Find its inverse. Find its inverse. Okay. Now, what are the steps? We'll follow that only and we'll be done with the answer. See, what are the steps? Number one. First, write y is equal to that function. Okay. Step number two. Make x the subject of the formula. X the subject of the formula means write x in terms of y. Any problem so far? I just brought the one on the other side, divide by two. Correct. Now this fellow, focus on this fellow. Focus on this. In this function, if you replace your y with an x, then the answer that you got is your inverse of the function. And we are done. Right? Happy with this? Simple steps to be followed. Nothing challenging in this. Okay? You can check this out also quickly. Verification also you can do. So let me do a verification also. If you feed 2x minus 1 into this, see what will happen. Let me do this step. F of f inverse x, and I'll also do f inverse f of x. Both of them I'll check whether it is giving me x or not. If it doesn't give me x, means whatever I've done will not be correct. So I'm feeding this function now to this function. So it'll become 2 times x plus 1 by 2 minus 1. That will give you 2, 2 cancels. So x plus 1 minus 1, that will give me x. Wonderful. So what I did was correct. Now I'm feeding this function to the x over here. Okay. So this one gets cancelled. So 2x by x, sorry, 2x by 2, I'm back to x again. So this is also correct. So whatever I've done is absolutely, absolutely correct. Any doubt in this three-step mechanism of finding the inverse, please highlight. Any doubt? Okay, so in the interest of time, I will take one more question. Then in the problem solving session, you can solve many questions on this. So let me take a question on this. Okay, this is an option-based question. Let f be defined from r minus 4 by 3 to r as 4x by 3x plus 4. As 4x by 3x plus 4. So this is how my function has been defined. Okay. The inverse of f is g. Okay. Now you have to find which of them is g of y. Which of them is g of y. That means you have to find f inverse y. That means you have to stop at the second step. Let me go back to the previous slide. This thing is your f inverse y. So you have to stop at this step. Okay, you don't have to replace the x back. Understood? What is supposed to be done? Let's do it. Let's everybody work this out and tell me the result. I'll switch on the poll. Let's have the answer in 2 minutes time. Okay, let's end the poll now. Most of you have voted. No, not most of you. Okay, please vote. Please vote, everybody. Last 10 seconds I'm giving to vote. Everybody, please vote. In the count of 5, I'll stop. At the count of 5, I'll stop. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. I'm going to stop now. Okay. So maximum people have gone for option B. Let's see option B is correct or not. Let's see option B is correct or not. See, follow the steps. So the question is pretty simple, pretty understandable. You have been given a function. You have been given inverse. We have to find gy. Okay. Earlier we used to find gx or f inverse. You can write it as f inverse y also. Okay. So the steps are pretty simple. The first step is write y is equal to 4x by 3x plus 4. Next step is making x the subject of the formula. X the subject of the formula. So how will I do that? Simple, cross multiply. So 3x plus 4 times y is equal to 4x. Okay. So 3xy plus 4y is equal to 4x. Correct. So you can say 4y is equal to 4x minus 3xy. Take x common. It will become something like this. Right. It is not as easy as we had taken in our examples. It is slightly more complicated, but nevertheless, it is not difficult. Okay. The moment you have got this, my dear, your job is over. This itself is your F inverse Y, right? Here you don't have to substitute Y with X because they have not asked. They have not asked for it. Okay. So this itself is your GY. So 4y by 4 minus 3y is your answer. 4y by 4 minus 3y, absolutely correct. B was absolutely correct. Very good, everybody. Very good. So is this idea set in? Okay. Now, next class, before we start a new chapter, which chapter is going on in your this thing? Before you closed? Relation functions was over. Any other chapter was going on? Or should I pick up a chapter on my own? Any suggestions from your side?